What's up guys, it's me, Jeremy. So we've made quite a lot of what could have been videos in the past, but one topic that we haven't actually looked at all that much is skins. And just like Champions, Riot does go through a ton of iterations when it comes to perfecting skin designs, and a lot of your favorite in-game skins, well, could have ended up looking quite a lot different. And since Riot has been a little bit transparent showing off some of their skin iterations, we're going to be taking a look at some of the versions of skins that were in early development and didn't make it into the game. And if you guys enjoyed the video, definitely hit that like button and let's begin. So the first skin we wanted to talk about today is also one that actually would have ended up being the most different on our list today, and it's Dark Star Thresh. Now it's easy to guess that a skin like this could have ended up looking quite a lot different, but in fact it goes a lot further than that. You know, Riot knew that they needed a legendary skin for Thresh, as players and pros love him so much, but they didn't have a definitive concept in mind for him at the time. And the skin development team received a request to design a legendary Thresh skin from their higher-ups, one that would of course amplify his sadistic characteristics 100 times over and really help players live up to Thresh's own twisted brand of evil in-game. Now, around 20 people submitted pitches for the Thresh skin, and in fact, there was even a much-loved Beekeeper Thresh concept that was actually rejected because it didn't really get the evil feel across for him. Instead, one concept was voted as the winner almost unanimously, and that was, of course, Darkstar Thresh. From this point forward, it was a case of iteration and refinement. Darkstar Thresh could have appeared in a number of different ways, all with different styles and colors, in an attempt to bring the concept to life. The concept artist Hellstern had drafted one particular concept that featured the galaxy around his head, and although everyone loved this idea, there was a lot of concern if it could have been made to look as awesome in an actual in-game model, and after a few tests later, it actually proved to be possible, and Riot continued iterating on his designs, along with remodeling and redoing animations, until Darkstar Thresh was finally brought to life. Now the next skin we're taking a look at is Project Echo, and Riot were actually a lot closer to the mark with this skin with their initial exploration this time, since they knew from the start that it was just going to be a Project skin. The first concepts for Project Echo were quite diverse and attempted to highlight different parts of his design. For example, one of the concepts is focused on his genius as shown by the lab coat, and others are more directed at showing him being, you know, kind of like this punky youth sort of character. One really sweet concept that didn't make it into the final design was a hologram mohawk. You know, essentially it was just about detaching one of Echo's key features and turning it into something that would be really representative of what the project line was all about. But they decided it was a little bit weird and didn't really make all that much sense from a thematic perspective. You know, it's usually the weapons, the visors that are holograms on the project skins after all, so a mohawk was a little bit too edgy, I guess. Every detail was iterated numerous times, you know, different gloves, different shoes, hood, no hood, and a bunch of changes to the hairstyle, of course, were important as they are all key to Echo's image as a whole. They managed to narrow things down to two concepts overall. One was rejected because the mohawk wasn't really what you would expect to see on Echo, so they went with the other one and continued to flesh it out until they ended up with the perfect mix of Echo and the project theme. Now next up, we're talking about a skin that is not just one skin, but 10 skins of course, and it's Elementalist Lux, you know, the latest ultimate skin available for purchase in League of Legends. So unlike the other skins that we're talking about in this video, we don't necessarily know a lot about how these skins themselves could have been different. After all, Riot just picks 10 elements and then iterated those specific styles until everything kind of looked right. So interestingly enough, this was definitely not the biggest issue when it came to Elementalist Lux. The main issue was finding a way to get around the huge memory problem that Riot had encountered when it came to developing a skin with 10 different appearances. Normally, one full skin takes about 20 megabytes of in-game memory, up to a maximum of 30. And because Elementalist Lux has 10 parts that are all equal in size and scope to a normal regular skin, that would mean her ultimate skin alone would be a minimum of 200 megabytes of game memory, which is actually quite a lot, especially for just a cosmetic, and as a result, it was an absolute nightmare for players with slower PCs, so there was no way that Riot could go ahead with the skin concept without actually managing to fix that issue. The first step towards fixing this problem was to compress a lot of the animations and reduce as many polygons on the model as possible. So they had to remove actually quite a bit of artistic freedom to make sure the textures were small, all in the hopes that they could vastly reduce the size of each skin without sacrificing quality. The big issue that remained was in the form of visual effects, which have their own textures, animations, and sounds. You know, there's quite often a lot of visual effects on each skin, and in Elementalist Lux's case, well, we're talking about 10 times as many as normal, not to mention the fact that every skin animation is super flashy and very, you know, energetic and just much more than you would expect from a regular skin individually. And the solution here with this one was to reduce the sizes of the textures by doing something that was called gray packing. So for example, let's say you normally have one particular particle texture and you have 10 copies of it all in different color schemes. With gray packing as a technique, it would be just one particular texture with separate color channels, red, green, and blue. That way the artist can just pick from a color palette to add color or brightness, effectively allowing them to reuse the same texture and just change its appearance for each form of Lux skin. Hopefully that made sense. Anyway, the same went for gradient maps, which were used to add colorful tints to the simple textures. Essentially, instead of using, you know, say 100 different particle textures, Ride would only use 10 and then just apply filters to them in different ways. And this, as a result, saved a ton of space and combined with some tweaks to the effect system to stop wasting memory, you know, some tune-ups and stuff, and min-maxing, it ended up being possible for Riot to load 10 different skins for a single champion without compromising the memory or the skin quality as a whole. Kind of an interesting story for the development, at least, I thought. And next up, we're looking at Arcade Ari, and as with Project Echo, the arcade theme was decided beforehand, so Ari didn't end up getting a ton of different concepts thrown around before settling on the arcade theme, which means that Riot could get started straight away with coming up with references and concepts for the skin. Since arcade skins are meant to be kind of like a celebration of retro video games, they start off each arcade skin by looking at a couple of different sources, whether they're original arcade video games from back in the day, maybe even some fan arts, and potentially even cosplays created by the community. And Arcade Ari had four different major concepts to go off of. One that was a little bit similar to Princess Peach, another that was a super jazzy retro skin, and another that was more of a sci-fi concept. Now, Riot settled on the concept that was more similar to the style that other arcade skins had been created with so far, rather than just having another theme that was a little bit different that would run parallel to the existing arcade theme. Again, kind of just a cool example of the iterations that Riot goes through when they narrow down which parts of a skin they like, which ones they don't, so that they can take their favorite bits and put them together until they end up with a finished product that really just looks awesome. Now for the next one we wanted to talk about today, it's not necessarily about any specific skin, it's more about groups of skins actually. So when Riot develops skins for a skin line or theme or whatever you want to call it, there's usually two ways that it works. Occasionally they will release single skins that slot in nicely to already existing skin lines, but recently there's been more of a focus on releasing groups of skins together and giving them like a shared teamwork sort of splash art. And designing these splash arts is of course really important because it has to highlight all of the best parts of each separate skin individually, while also making sure the overall scene does the skin line's theme enough justice as a whole. And the League of Legends art book actually had a really cool example of this using the arcade skin teamwork art, which features Miss Fortune, Sona, and Riven all together. They experimented with quite a few different concepts, with different poses, different backdrops, before finding one that really suited the arcade skins by putting them in the middle of a battle against their rival skins, Battle Boss Blitzcrank and Final Boss Veigar. You can also see a few other examples of these teamwork splash arts with some of the other skin lines, you know, such as the Pool Party Splash, which features Draven, Rek'Sai, Zac, Lulu, and Dr. Mundo. Every skin shows off its key features, and there's a lot going on as a whole, so it really draws in your attention, and overall it's just an awesome piece of art. The same goes for the other teamwork splashes, like the Prehistoric Ones, Project, Guardian of the Sands as well, and there's quite a few more too. It's actually pretty impressive that Riot manages to capture the special features of all the different champion skins in the game in the same amount of space that a conventional splash art takes up, and it really helps tie together the skin line and honestly just makes you want to play with all of them. Either way though, that's just about going to wrap things up on today's video about skins, you know, how they're developed, and how differently quite a few of them could have ended up going. You know, despite being two very different departments of Riot, both the skin and the champion development teams share very similar processes and design philosophies, where they focus on reiterating concepts until they find something that really stands out. And it's a huge part of why Riot are so effective at churning out just insanely high quality new skins to the game. You know, they really do take the necessary time to just perfect the idea rather than just kind of fleshing out the first concept and hoping that the players like it. Either way though, definitely let us know in the comment section below what you thought about the different skin concepts today. Maybe you liked one of them more than the other, or maybe you thought one of them could have potentially been better than the skin that actually got released. Either way, definitely let us know in the comment section below, and looks like that's gonna be it for me. If you guys enjoyed the video, drop a like, subscribe if you want. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you guys next time.